Well, whatever you make of his politics and the new man at the top, we can guess one thing. It's surely a very proud moment for his family. And we can find out if it is, because we've got his dad, his father, Stanley Johnson, with us this morning. Proud daddy this morning?
Totally proud. I mean, it can't happen very often that one son or daughter becomes prime minister. I mean, you know, a historian might be able to work out, you know, how many fathers have been around. Yeah. Not many, I would have thought.
Did you shed a tear?
Well, I kind of grimaced a little bit at the sort of thought that, well, you know, from now on, I'm going to be known as, in the old days, I thought, well, you know, let's get on with things anyway. But now I can see this as, I mean, first father, that kind of thing. I'm thrilled, absolutely thrilled. Of course, he got a massive, massive job, and I will.
Well, some say a poison chalice, Stanley, don't they?
No, I don't think it's a poison chalice, because I tell you what, even though I started off, as you know, as a Remainer, I worked for the European Commission for that thing, I'm 100% convinced that we have to do what the great British public said, get out, that's what they voted for. And honestly, I think Boris's plan is a good one, and he's got to push it through now. He will push it through.
Has he got enough support from MPs? I mean, you say the public, the democratic vote was to get out, but there are so many MPs against it.
Good point, but I think what is going to change the situation now is that he and his diplomats are going to go out to the 28 countries, 27 countries of the EU, and they're going to say to them, look, folks, you simply cannot persist in saying this is non-negotiable. You are driving the whole thing, you know, to a cliff edge. It's not us who are going to the cliff edge.
But your son is saying that he will leave with no deal. He will take the UK out with no deal.
Do you believe he
will do that, or is he posturing?
I think it's certainly not posturing. It is absolutely inevitable. This will happen unless our colleagues in Europe realise that they have the chance. They have the chance to offer something which is acceptable.
But they've already said they won't move.
But it's no good saying. Look, I worked 20 years in Brussels. It's no good saying they say they won't. They jolly well will. I think there'll be people around Europe, for example, not necessarily in Brussels, but in different countries of Europe saying, come on. It'd be totally ironic. I mean, you're from Northern Ireland. Totally ironic if we ended up by saying, actually, in order to save, you know, Ireland, we're going to keep the backstop, when actually that will then mean we have a no-deal situation, which would be the worst possible result for Ireland. It's nonsense.
But except a lot of people, especially the business community in Northern Ireland, would say a backstop's a very, very good thing for them economically. But however, my friend, it's fascinating watching you, because I feel as if it could be Boris I'm looking at. And I just wonder how like you he is, or how like you, him, you are, the affectations, the mannerisms there.
Affectations, or wait a minute, that's a tricky word. Well, you think I'm putting it on? Don't think.
But the mannerisms.
Mannerisms.
Yes, yes.
Well, that's very interesting.
Yes.
Mannerisms. I don't think I consciously ape my children.
Does he ape you?
No, I very much doubt it. Do you know something? We all do our thing. By the way, I am proud of it. Of course, I'm very keen on the whole political side, but I'm also keen on all sorts of things beyond
that. Have you seen him since that moment he was declared the victor?
Have you seen him,
spoken to him?
Well, I've definitely seen him at that moment since he's been declared victor.
Yeah, Stanley, is it because you're worried now of saying something that would affect him?
I'm not worried, no, on the contrary. I actually see at the moment people like me who have had a long experience of Europe, and by the way, quite a long experience in the environment, do have something to say. And my line here would be to say, actually, the crucial thing, just to come back to what I was saying, the crucial thing is to realise that it's Europe which has the secret to this one. And we need to go. Mr. Raab, Dominic Raab, has just been made Foreign Secretary. He's got to get his diplomats off the summer beaches into the capitals and saying, look,
Stanley, what's interesting at the moment? You've got all this good weather and, you know, people are quite upbeat. We have a new Prime Minister. He definitely seems to be a glass half full sort of guy, as opposed to a glass half empty.
Oh, well, I think, you know something, I can hear the Irish pub there. Yes, I mean, that is it, glass half full. He is, you know, if I think of the qualities you've got, it's determination, it's intelligence, it's humour, and finally, you've got to add on experience. Don't forget, you know, of all the candidates out there, it's a pretty long experience. He was an MP in 2001, 8 years as Mayor of London, any number of years, you know, as a writer. So we've got to, I mean, look, I would say this, wouldn't I? But my worry is we've got to get off this Brexit stuff and we've got a chance of really moving ahead to really important stuff like the Brazilian rainforest.
Did you always look at your son when he went into politics and think one day that he'll be Prime Minister?
I don't know if I thought that far ahead. You know, I take one day at a time. I mean, I was terribly pleased when things happened. Terribly pleased when things happened to any of my children. Terribly pleased when I get invited onto the This Morning Show. Brilliant. I mean, I'm a glass half full man as well. What a triumph.
No, I could see so much of you in him. He talks there and he has the use of the hands and things that he talks and the sense of humour and things that you have. Because, you know, the truth is he could be the shortest lived prime minister that we ever have, because if he doesn't pull the plug on the 31st of October...
I want to tell you, whatever happens, that plug is going to be pulled on the 31st of October, and it'll be pulled with a deal or without a deal. That is going to happen. That is, in any case, the default situation. In order to change the law, you'd have to get a majority in Parliament.
Do you keep in touch with him? I mean, I know it's been an amazing sort of 24 hours or so to be involved in, but will you have influence with him? Will he listen to you?
Not. Or do you see him very much?
I don't see why anybody should, you know, think I'm going to have any influence at all. That would be a total misreading of the situation. Even I'm a grown-up, he's a grown-up. We all get on with our things. I shall be for the next 10 days, I shall be, you know, in the deepest darkness. I shall be in sunlit Australia, that's for sure. No, but, you know, they are means of communication. And, of course, it's not just... I'm totally thrilled today to see that my other son, Joe, has...
He's in the cabinet.
Well, no, he's not. He's attending cabinet, which I think is jolly nice to be attending cabinet, I tell you what. I mean, that's fantastic. And he's back as minister in universities or business, something like that.
Yeah,
it's good stuff. So good day for me. I'm totally thrilled. But if I were actually, to tell you the truth, if I was today where Boris is, I would say, let's get Brexit done. And then there's cackle, you know, things like the Amazon rainforest. Why have we got 40 degrees temperature out here today?
Okay.
Amazon rainforest. Go and see Mr. Bolsonaro.
I mean, that means you would agree with these people on the Mall. So, okay, your son's on the way to see the Queen.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, I'm sure he probably wasn't. If I were there, I might have got out. Okay, be a tiny bit late maybe for Her Majesty. But you could say to these chaps, look, I'm about to be Prime Minister. I'm going to put climate change right at the top of my agenda. That's why I'm going to see Mr. Bolsonaro in Brazil, for example. Yeah, I mean, look, I have marched down Whitehall often enough. I've marched to number 10 Downing Street often enough. Thrilled, by the way, to see that we have just decided, the House of Lords passed it yesterday, that we're going to ban the use of wild animals in circuses. I've campaigned for that. I got Mr. Cameron to give an absolutely unbreakable promise. That was 10 years ago. Mm. Well, we finally got
it. We must come back and talk about
that. Well, they say the apple never falls far from the tree. So, you know...
I think the tree might grow up where the apple is. Who can say?
Stanley,
no, honestly, wonderful to be here.
Thank you. And
father of our Prime Minister.
Thank you. Thank you very much indeed. And enjoy it while it lasts.
Are you talking about the weather?
Stanley Johnson, thank you very much.